like to take the opportunity to thank the organizers for putting this together and for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to present joint work here with Juan Hill and Carmen. This work, as well as some of the other work we did together, fit into, well, the grander scheme of questions that are raised at the technical part. So what's the big picture, big question? Trying to understand the analysis and spectral properties of elliptic operators of manifolds with certain types of and like outlined in the previous talk, we're talking from interested in when singularities should not be too bad, stratified spaces with certain kinds of massive incomplete geometries. So to think about a polyhedron invested in this space, that type of problem. And what makes this task primarily complicated is the incompleteness of three-dimensional geometry. And incompleteness, well, is at fault for the fact that the operators, the metric operators, are not essentially self-adjoint individually. There are, in fact, many, many, many self-adjoint extensions, and those are associated with what you think of the realization of boundary problems associated with singular operators. And another motivation that is not so much of geometric nature is to try to understand PDEs with certain kinds of irregular coefficients. Here's an example from mathematical physics, the Harmonic form Hamiltonian, that describes a non-relativistic spinless quantum particle that interacts with a magnetic field that's confined to a thin solid field, so there's some kind of masses. What physicists then do is drop the coordinate along the solenoid and you'll idealize it to two-dimensional problem, and the Newtonian describes that particle and is given by this formula on the slide, and having interactions with a delta-like potential located at the origin. The magnetic potential in this case is given by this formula here, and you see what happens when you have a singular behavior, singularities that are present in potential. And this operator, initially acting outside the solenoid that we replace it, has infinite many self-adjoint extensions. So initially acting on test number, test efficiency increases to 2, so it does have infinite many of these. And each one is physically interpreted as some sort of interaction with the particle. This is an example, this particular Hamiltonian, with dimensional reduction in 2 dimensions, that you can understand in the framework of what's called cone operator. If you do not do the dimensional reduction, keep the axis coordinate, it fits into the framework of wedge operators. These are two things that we talk about. So the general setting for the type of questions that I wish to address in this talk and that we'll be addressing now in work, it gives some functionalistic framework. So purely abstract. Consider a Hilbert space closed, densely defined operator, A on the Hilbert space. And what you should think about is, H being, of course, a two-space associated with some Riemannian manifold, and A being its domain as the realization of some elliptic operator in that. You consider a given sector or a complex plane. If you remind you, such a sector is called a sector of even row for maximum decay for such realization. If the resolvent exists for sufficiently large values of the parameter in the sector, and has optimum decay as lambda tends to move along the sector. So that's what's called rays in the growth, set of new growth. And the third contribution here, which is some function replacement for compactness, the relative embedding equilibrium, the domain embeds into the Hilbert space, not just compactly, but a little better solution. So under these completely functional precautions, it's a very easy exercise to see that when you take the resolvent, a sufficiently high power, it's going to be a trace class operator in the Hilbert space, it's a tool. And when you put the trace on it, you get a function defined in the sector for sufficiently large relative to the parameter. And that function is not an arbitrary function, it's a symbol. So it does have a certain order to be differentiated here. This is a very rough behavior of that trace. An elliptic theory, it's a theorem, of course. The order that you define is typically related to the manifold that you just manifold of the operator. That has to do with why it's other topics that great possibility early on. I mean, this is very much the same. And all of this analysis of large parameter behavior for resolvents is intertwined with some other important questions, objects that appear in geometric analysis, namely heat equations, heat traces, heat invariants, and zeta functions. So resolvents, zeta functions, and fundamental solution for heat equations, heat traces, all related by certain integral transforms. If you understand one, you understand the other two. Okay? So theorems, classical theorems about isotropic expansions of heat traces, neuromorphic structure of zeta functions, and so on and so forth, are refinements of the statement here on the trace of the resolvent. Namely, you're not just having the rough estimates, but you're interested in isotropics of that trace as found in symphony and segment. And what has been proved many, many years ago, well, 40 years ago, in the case of closed manifolds by CD, and then subsequently also CD Krainer group, because some of these manifolds mentioned, so the classical case of closed manifolds and good manifolds, as well as realizations that can be bounded by problems and compact manifolds with boundary. So all the classical objects, which is also geometry projects group. Those traces, those resolvent traces, have a very specific isotropic structure. They turn out to be step 1 over n log polyhomogeneous things. So what does it mean? It's not that tends to infinity. This type of isotropic structure shows up. And you see what happens here. These lambda terms, these powers are responsible for the orders. You're starting at dimension of the manifold divided by order, minus the power that you're interested in. And as you progress, you're improving by 1 over n, n being the order of the power. And we look at pseudo-differential operators rather than differential operators. Well, you don't need to don't have constant terms here, but what you can get at most are polynomial terms in the log to the graph. And in fact, not arbitrary ones, but just linear terms, probably, etc. So this has been proved many, many years ago, and it has proven to be remarkably stable in Elliptic theory. Yeah, this particular structure. And because of this, it was the reason for very general expectations. Everything that's reasonable should be. So this is the most general structural result that we expect. So we see we're not doing a very fine analysis. It's really purely an isotopic analysis. We're not paying too much attention to the names. So everything that decays rapidly as lambda tends to infinity, we do not pay attention to what the fine structure is. And one of the messages is actually, well, this expectation, and many years that it has been around, that happens to be in singular business, grossly unjust. So a lot of very weird things actually happen. Let's talk about the objects that I will address today. Wedge operators, so some issues about the differential topology of manifolds to edge singularities. So we're going to look at manifolds that are smooth outside some singular set. Near the singular set, we have a structure of local trivial cone manifolds. So why we use the notation is going to be our edge and the variance corresponding to variance on these edges here. X is like an X, so variable is cones, so there's a variable here. And we have a generalized cones, so those cross sections here, Z are closed manifolds. And so this is the local structure of the singular set. And when you take this cross section here, you just bump it into the singularity, so you bump it into the singular points here, so you're blowing up those cones. Then what you end up getting is a smooth manifold with boundary, where the boundary is fibered. So you have a cross section here, Y, which was the edge, and the fibers, they are this cross section C that you get by bumping in. So this way of providing the differential topology, setting for the differential topology of these objects, that's the perspective that has been primarily used on the same paper. Special cases here. What happens when those bases are points or several points? And you talk about conical singularities. So here's a manifold with conical singularity, here's a conical base, and this lower procedure, which is again a manifold with boundary. This time, the interpretation of the boundary is it's all fiber. And another special case, the fibers can be points. In which case, you also just talk about manifold with boundary, well, and the entire boundary is space. Okay? So, particularly interesting is also when you consider multiple points, not just a single point. So, here, multiple points means multiple singularities. Multiple points here means you have talking about generalized transmission problems. So for that, consider just two points. So what's the situation like that? So you have an ambient manifold. Inside there you have a submanifold of co-dimension 1 on the surface. And there are two directions, one side of it and the other side of it, locally. Okay? So you have a distance variable to that manifold. Okay? So x represents the distance of either side of the manifold locally. And the two points just tell you what side you're in. Okay? So in the case of two points here, it represents the setting for transmission problems. And you can also look at several points that would be like generalized transmission problems, ZE manifolds. And there's a structure bundle that determines the geometries of the objects that we are interested in, the wedge cotangent bundle. So the wedge cotangent bundle is a certain smooth vector bundle on the manifold, the blown-up manifold, the smooth manifold bundle. And its smooth sections you can identify with certain one forms that are generated on the boundary layer. Namely, its smooth sections are all one forms in the manifold that when you put them back to fibers of vibration boundary, where you put back to each fiber emissions. That means the coordinates, nothing else but this, a local frame for this bundle here, is given by these differential forms. So once again, x was the defining function of the boundary, y's are the coordinates on the base, and z's are the coordinates on the fibers. So these here, they provide all the local frames for the sections of that bundle. That's a nice smooth vector bundle. And wedge metrics, sometimes also called incomplete edge metrics, are the reasonably metrics introduced on the interior of that manifold that you get by taking the smooth metric on this wedge tangent bundle. Okay? And these reasonably metrics have to be completed. So look in particular, if you have a product structure, so then dx squared plus x squared dz squared is a cone that presents this cone bundle structure that we have been talking about earlier, plus dy squared adds an edge. Okay. So more generally, these objects are being on the edge of wedge metrics. And once you have that, you can talk about, of course, analytic objects. Now you have a two-space perspective of such metrics. And everything here that has wedge geometry and wedge objects gets this superscript double in this part. Okay. And you can use, of course, scalar objects as well as section information. So we suppress the boundaries over time, everything will be the same work systems. So what are the operators then? The question. So there is a quick, very quick delta. The wedge operator for the M is an operator acting in this function of this particular time. X was a defining function, it's a single time. Okay? And B is a so-called edge differential operator that does produce number 0, 9, and 1. I will come back to that a little later in the definition, but I will focus here on coordinate descriptions primarily. So this means you have to talk about differential operator on manifold, that the boundary has this particular structure. So look what happens. The differentiation in the variables in the base, they're always coupled with the defining function. So this degenerates at x equals 0, which is the boundary. The differentiations in normal direction also coupled. This degenerates at the boundary as well. The fiber derivatives, they are regular. The coefficients are smooth up to the boundary. And what makes this thing singular as a whole is the presence of this singular vector. Okay? So why would anyone be interested in this type of structure? Well, it occurs, for example, when you take a submanifold embedded in some ambient, and you take a tubular neighborhood here, and you use polar coordinates in the tubular neighborhood. So what you get, x is your radial direction, z is your spherical variable locally, and y is the coordinate on the submanifold. When you take an operator that is smooth in all variables in the ambient manifold, and you use coordinates in that fashion, that's the structure that you find. And likewise, geometric operators with respect to these wedge geometries that I used, Laplace Bertrami operators, Posch-Laplace and so on and so forth, with respect to this type of metric here, turns out to be an operator. So our analytic example, just to convince you that it's also our outer form of this one here, where these coordinates, radial and spherical coordinates, x and z, this is how the anatomy looks like. And this is then how it looks like as this kind. This happens to be a cone operator. So once again, cone operators means you don't have a base. The base is zero dimension, it just points. So this is why we don't have derivatives. But we still have the derivative, the defining function, and the bias. So this is a cone operator, the kind we just introduced. And when you don't do dimension reduction, well, you then have a dy squared out here, and then you pull out your x to the negative 2, that produces what we had seen earlier, these derivatives x and y as well. So that would be three dimensions, the wedge. So there's a bunch of simples, principal simples associated with objects that will control what's going on. But you think with these standard principles. So this was our local expression near the boundary. This is then how principal simple looks like. And something interesting happens here. When you take your singular factor, you pull it in, you cancel the ones you're getting from the degeneracy to the differentiations. So what you are left over is a little bit of degeneracy. But that's going to be absorbed in a new covariant like this. So this here will be replaced by this covariant. So what you get is smooth projection. And what this really means is nothing else but that this principal symbol with the boundary lifts to something, to smooth object that lives on the wedge potential. So once it gets off the wedge potential, put the x on the other side, c tilde is the chord in the wedge potential. When I multiply by x, I get the ordinary covariant. That's what it was, because when, once again, draw the frame for the wedge potential when x is easier, x is equal. So therefore, well, you see what it is, c tilde x. So this shows you that this thing has a very defined principal symbol on this structure, on this intersection. And wedge elasticity, W elasticity, integrated with that thing. That's going to be a standing function. Then there are two more objects that will control what's going on in the boundary. What are the actions? Number one, the so-called conormal symbol or initial family. So this is again the local description of the objects. So out of this, how you get it, what you're drawing out your derivatives, your x, the x derivatives, and the sigma. And every other present that you have for x, you're freezing it at the boundary of x is zero. This is what you get. Okay? So particular all the objects here that are in base direction, say rubber. And this is a local term, but you give it a global meaning, namely, you consider this global objects on fiber over the base point of time. And what you have here is a holomorphic family of differential operations, fiber. Okay. And under the assumption of wedge elasticity, a little bit of an differential theory, I'll show rather easily then, on the fixed y. If you look at this as a holomorphic function back in here, then this is meromorphic invertible. This is a holomorphic fragment. Holomorphic family will be involved. And a little more is true when you consider a strip, horizontal strip of finite width, you'll have at most finite dimensions. That's true. This thing is rather important and controls some aspects of what's going on at the boundaries. The thing that's even more important than that. Controls much more of what's going on in the boundaries, the so-called normal. Again, I'm not following Graves' advice, I'm not giving you things in invariant terms, I'm giving you things in brutal coordinates. Okay? So here it is. So here's how it looks like. This is something that's parameterized by the cotangent of the base, of the y beta on the base. And what you do is you're freezing coefficients on the boundary. You're drawing out differentiations here in the base directions by the covariables, and look at this object. This object lives on something else. It lives on what I will denote by wedge. So y, once again, was the fiber of the Lorentz vibration associated with base of y. And this wedge indicates that we're just looking at the cone of this, but not a bounded cone, an infinite. So this thing here, the infinite cone, is getting also given cone joints. And we're looking at this as an unbounded operator that we associate two spaces back to cone joint. So this is just definitions of objects. So some basic proposition here that tells you something about this normal family. If your operator is wedge elliptic and following maps, the minimal extension, so what's the minimal extension? It's the closure of an operator acting on compact. They are too close. The domains, they do not vary arbitrarily over the tangent, they only vary with the baseline. So they're going to be determined by the single section of the tangent, of the base. So it's independent. the maximal domain. So what's the maximal domain? So you're looking at all the two functions that are met by the operator in there. There's only a finite dimensional gap between the minimum and maximum. Just a finite dimensional gap. And away from the zero section here, this thing happens to be fractal, where both as an operator from the minimal domains as from the maximum domains, but it's one that is from the other because of the there's quite a bit of what goes into this to actually prove it. There's a lot more to that than it actually seems. It looks rather innocent. So what you have to do is you understand these types of cone degeneracies and x equals zero. You have to understand what's going on in the opening at x equals infinity, that is a scattering operator, scattering conditions, and so on and so forth. But that overall is this problem. So this is something, so one lesson learned from this is when you're looking at something that is elliptic in this sense, well, the second simple thing is almost invertible. As I mentioned before, the classical theory of manifolds with boundary regular elliptic operators should fit the bill. And here's what these objects are in this case. So in the file is just a point, you're just looking at smooth manifolds with boundary. What are those objects? The regular elliptic operators, smooth coefficients of the boundary. Well, number one, the wedge cotangent is nothing else but the ordinary cotangent up to the boundary. And this wedge principle symbol is just an extended principle. So that's nothing. Number two, this conormal symbol initial family, which does not show up in the classical theory of problems, and here's why, but because it's extremely explicit. Here's how it looks like. In every such case, you get a convertible term phi of y, and these very explicit factors down here. So you know what it's like, so you don't have to impose any conditions on it. It's a little bit more interesting when you look at a regular elliptic problem, but not in the standard two space, but you look at it in the singulari two space. But if you did that, this thing suddenly would be that much more.
What is I?
What is I? This is a comparison. So in standard L2 space, this is also going to be invertible where it matters. But when you look at it in a singularly weighted L2 space, that may actually fail, and then it's become wrong. But classically, you're looking at standard L2 space, so it doesn't show up. And thirdly, the normal family is a rather prominent object that you see in the classical theory of elliptic boundary problems. It's the boundary symbol. So what's the boundary symbol? Well, we take the principal symbol of the operator, you increase coefficients at the boundary, and act in normal directions and parameterize it by the variable variable. That's a family of ODPs in normal direction. And that family of ODPs determines everything when it comes to what is a well-posed elliptic problem. Shapiro-Lobatinsky condition is expressed in terms of these objects and the corresponding objects associated with boundary conditions. So this is a very prominent object classically, and that's going to be a very prominent object. Okay. So some rough, very basic theorems. This definition is just taken from the seminal paper from 91. So I told you we'll come back to what edge differential operators are. So we're going to do it again. So by the D of M, there's a V algebra of edge vector fields, which are nothing else but a smooth vector fields in the manifold that are on the boundary tangent at five. So that means, again, in coordinates, that when you look at the boundary, those vector fields were generated by these particular ones. So x dx, in normal direction, x d by j, again, y with a variable sum base, and these are so the smooth coefficients, these are the little bit of this is the Lie algebra on the bracket. And so it has a developing algebra of edge differential operators, so those guys, and smooth functions, they constitute. And with this, we can introduce the edge Sobolev spaces. So what are they? So M here is a positive integer, so it's always the order of our operator. And also this, of course, what we have S. So the edge Sobolev space, what is that? These are all U in our L2 space, for which P U stays in L2 for all these edge differential operators up to M. So this is standard construction, but not based on all activities, but this particular kind of generator. So this is how you would show up in this work. The typical human space is space. So this space here is follows real that kind of space. And the first theorem is a semi-Fredholm theorem. So suppose your A is wedge elliptic, so it's cylindrical. And then there are two things going on that have to do with those two other objects that control what's going on at the boundary. So the first condition is on the conormal symbol. So once again, this was for every pi, family branch by sigma operators here on the pi. And that one was almost a curve. So remember here, as a function of sigma, it's one of the set. And the condition is invertibility for all case points. And for sigma confined to a very particular line. So this is a line that depends on the dimension of the manifold. And the reason for that is that we're looking at the operator in geometric L2 space. If we look at it in other weighted L2 spaces, you would have to replace that line by just another line. That's closer to the weight. But in the geometric L2 space, this is the line that you have to look at, horizontal line, confined to complex parameters, and you have to ask the question. And the second condition, the normal manifold. This is supposed to be injected outside the zero section. So once again, this was a Fredholm effect. And outside the zero section, but not really by the activity of it. And under these conditions, you can identify the minimal domain of the operator on the manifold. So once again, the minimal domain was the closure of the operator on the test assumptions toward the waveform function. That minimal domain is the weighted edge solvers. So that was the reason why I reminded you. You can happily identify this as well. And maybe the more important statement is that the minimal extension happens to be a semi-Fredholm operator from the middle domain to the space with finite dimensional curvature and closed range. And that's of course the bare minimum when you're asking yourself about what does well closeness mean? What does it mean? You want to have a Fredholm problem. Well, if you're on the minimal domain, you have an infinite dimensional curvature. So there is no way that you can associate extensions of the Fredholm. So the least that you would need to have is finite dimensional kernel domains, and under this condition you have. So the buzzwords, injectivity of the normal family, semi-Fredholm with finite dimensional kernel. And by duality, the positive dual term is here in this theorem. Once you have that, you can also say a similar statement about the maximum extension. So assumptions look similar, something that's elliptic, virtually. You again have invertibility of this conormal symbol on a certain line. The line is going to be a little bit different. So the lines by duality, they switch somehow. And you have surjectivity of the normal family on the maximum. The surjectivity of the normal family produces a semi-Fredholm operator for the maximum domain of finite coordinate. So injectivity, finite dimensional kernel, surjectivity, fundamental range, minimum maximum domains. So well-closeness goes on in between somehow and should be associated with invertibility. And I think that I was going to say that before. By the way, the proof of this, how would you prove that? You construct the parametrics of that operator from the left. I mean, so the left parameters are inversive on that operator. But that is, of course, quite a bit of technical effort to get that. For cone operators, you can say a little more. So cone operators, because again, you don't do your edge is free, just about the point. And that's more here on mesh. So for cone operator, you do not have to pay attention to the lines and cope with them just because. You have a finite dimensional gap between the maximum and the domains. You have seen that before the level of the normals. That's actually something you use. You have the closed extensions, the boundary conditions, all in between, and space and they are all going to be. So there is no issue there. But that is something which is truly special for this one. So I promised I would say a few words about resolvents and the main theorems about the case. when the minimalist tension happens to have control. That's a rare event. So that means you can associate a well-posed problem just by passing on the closure of the operator on test functions. So this is associated, for example, with general essential self-adjoints. So if you are lucky and you have a problem that is essential self-adjoint, it's going to be solved in the minimalist tension. So that's what. Okay. So here are the assumptions. So consider such a wedge operator and a set. But by the way, I do not assume anything about self-adjointness or adjoints. It's completely relative statements. First condition is on the principle cylinder. The principle cylinder is not allowed to have spectral community in set. So that's a logistical parameter. For instance, everywhere in the space. The second condition is literally the one that you already have seen in the context of a singular quantity. So the initial family should be directed on that line that has to do with our choice of spaces. And the third condition is that, as I said, the normal family will control things. So here we want to have invertibility of the normal family with parameter everywhere or co-vector parameters. So this is invertibility on the level of the model. It's the model. And under these assumptions, there is the first theorem. The sector lambda is a sector of the normal. So you're going to have a resolvent that exists that decays optimally. And even more so, a sufficiently high power of the resolvent, same as usual dimension of order, this power is a trace. And the trace has the usual asymptotics. So no surprises. Okay. So again, you have polynomial terms and logarithms associated with the standard powers that are part of the standard part of the arithmetic progression that you find. So no surprises for the extension. There's one thing though that's worthwhile mentioning. When does this expect that things are differential? Classically, for differential problems, you don't have any books. Okay? But here, for differential operators, you may have logs. And when do they show up? Well, when do they first tell by this extension? When you think. So the first log may show up. And the D was first term. So D was the dimension of the file. And that happens to be exactly the codimensional singular set. So we have a manifold and an singularity of codimensional +1. Well, then, your resolvent traces, they feel that the presence of singularity. First, you do not see the singularity of this pattern. Okay? That also explains why the classical theory, the second term, sees the boundary. Because the boundaries, we mentioned one of them, so the second term sees it. Okay? Well, we can do a lot better for cone operators than for wedge operators. So let me give you a theorem of cone operators. Once again, cone operators are the case of the integer. As a point to the dimension of the operator. So here it is. Consider an elliptic operator again, the same assumption, principle cylinder is on the log of spectrum in sector. But this time we're not confining ourselves to the matrix dimension, but to an arbitrary dimension. An arbitrary dimension. And, well, likewise, exactly as you would expect from Shapiro-Lobatinsky conditions. So there is something that you have to impose then. There must be a matching condition of your choice of boundary condition and the boundary. So is it a good choice? So for the operator, the symbol object on the boundary was the normal family. So it's a condition on the normal operator in this case, family points. And the domain, the boundary condition, has also a symbol of the boundary condition. That is another choice of boundary condition for that model object. You can say very explicitly what it is. There's an algorithm that tells you how to pass from your extension that you picked, your boundary condition that you picked here, the boundary condition that occurs here. It's fairly technical. I'm just going to say this has to do with, well, you take the coefficients of the operator at the boundary, you tailor extension up to the order of the operator, and there's some process, an algorithm, that tells you how to go from one to the other. And the assumption is, I'll rephrase it analytically, that for your normal object is associated with the symbol of the domain, that's going to be well behaved. That you can say this in very, very nice terms, I don't have the time to do that, so this is why I can just phrase it analytically. Okay? In this case, this is what happens. So we have the same line of generators. So we're going to have a segment in the row, the trace class, power of resolvent, and here's how the trace shows up. It expands, where the first n terms do not see anything that was to be expected as before, because now we have the point singularities that have full co-dimension, the full space, n. So those things do not see anything. There's one more term here that goes up that doesn't see anything. And here comes a lot of things that see a lot. Well, if things were normal or as was to be expected, things would just continue like this with possibly polynomial terms and logarithms. But that's not possible. In general, this thing is very much a piece that expands like this. So if things were the ordinary way, those powers here in lambda, they would just go down by step 1 over n, so those exponents that you see here would be just integers. They may not be integers. They can be other numbers. And previously, we had polynomial terms in logarithms. Well, what we can get now is rational terms, not just in logarithms, but also oscillatory phase terms. So those mu's are real numbers, so as lambda tends to infinity, these are oscillatory terms. Okay? And the principle, you can, so what are those confusions here? So how do you know what's showing up here? And how do you know what's showing up here? Well, this is all determined by, well, what's called the boundary spectrum of the operator. The boundary spectrum are the non-bijectivity points of the feminine symbol. I'll show you examples of that in the next slide. So first of all, what are the strange exponents here that show up? Well, this has to do, all of this has to do with how the non-bijectivity points of the polynomial symbol are well situated or aligned with respect to each other in a certain strip. That strip has to do with our choice of basic functions. Again, I'm going to show you these things. And in differences in imaginary parts, they have an impact on what can show up in the exponents. And oscillatory points, you know, they have to do with the real part of the same thing. A lot of this is quite nice, but of course we need to see what is that. So what are those points responsible for that? So once again, here's how it looked like. The cone operator, again, there are no y differentiations. This was the co-normal symbol of it, which is a holomorphic family that is geomorphic invertible. And the non-bijectivity points of that thing, we find out the many in each horizontal strip, I mentioned that before. And so there's a certain portion, a certain kind of strip that we're interested in, and that strip is this one. The ones that are in between these two ranges here, these two bounds, and again, the dimension of the manifold. And the dimension of the manifold only shows up because we look at it in geometric two space, we look at another weighted space, the weight will show up, not the dimension. And that strip has with every continuous order of our operator. Let's look at a specific example here. So consider an operator of Laplace type that you rewrite, normalize in this form, is something that goes back to certain rather important papers in this business of William and Seeley from the 1795. So this is the kind of object that you consider, and V of X is a family of Laplace type operators on the boundary, so on the fiber, as move up to X equals 0, the boundary itself. That is a common operator, which is conventionally provided in this form. For the thing to be, so when you Laplacians and production, so what you find out, when you find them for this family, they're all sitting down, they're all Laplace type, but the thing at the boundary is bound to be lower negative quarter. That's just what you find. Okay, so it's just an abstraction of what you get when you look at Laplacians. So for this thing here, you look at the conormal zero official family, once again, this calls for replacing those x dx's by sigma, so here they are. And otherwise putting x equals zero everywhere. So here's what it is. I'm picking on. So this is a polynomial term, product in the complex variable sigma, and it parameterizes here the spectrum of that guy. So where is this not invertible? Well, so here it is. And we have a solution of the product equation here, where lambda is parameterized by the spectrum of the boundary. That's also one of the reasons why we call it the boundary spectrum. Okay. And since all these eigenvalues here are at least negative quarter or higher, and you can look at the product solution formula, we find that all solutions to these equations are imaginary. So for this type of operators, all your non-bijectivity points, they sit on the imaginary axis. And therefore, well, things turn out to be a little nicer. So this was its general structure, and that thing was rather wild in general. But for the case that I just described, if your non-magic tipping points are just a line, measuring axis on the other line, well, it's still bad. You're still having exponents here that are not integer or something that happens. It has to do with how those eigenvalues are situated on that line, the gaps between them, that will determine what happens. The gaps between them. And you can still have rational functions in log lambda, but you don't have any oscillatory terms. Okay. But then the thing is, the more you assume, the easier it gets. And since most naturally what people have been considering was Friedrich's extensions and so on and so forth. So the domain is extensions with a lot of additional structure. And to make a long story short, the more you assume, the more structure, the more regularity you assume, the more the thing looks like what you have expected already. So, for example, there's a certain kind of property of these extensions have to do with scaling the normal coordinates. So if you scale it, then you're essentially not running out of it. And that's essentially what Friedrich's extension is. You're funny exponents here, but they're not funny. So you don't see them anymore. So the more you put in as assumptions, the easier, the more traditional it gets. Okay? And this is why people have not observed these things until fairly recently. I should give some credits here. No, not yet. I'll just summarize what it actually means for zeta functions. You can point out in detail how we get from the result of the zeta function, but you know that. So this was the general structure of these other topics with its very wide terms. Now what can happen? Well, observation one, the zeta function can have poles at unusual locations. So the usual locations are this arithmetic progression. You can have poles now at other spots. When does it happen? It happens when your exponents, those nu's, are not integers, but the rational term is still very low. Then you do have a pole in the morphic configuration at an unusual spot. And it can even get a little worse than that. A zeta function may even fail to extend meromorphically at all to the complex. And when does that happen? Well, it happens always when this term here, which is rational in principle, is genuinely rational and not polynomial. So this rational not polynomial the other axis. The zeta function doesn't extend. And those things have been observed, and now comes a time that I will give some references. Ray mentioned a little bit of the paper, it's a little more general than that one. I think the first couple of similarities is this one here from 79, where he actually looked at, well, the heat invariance of the Friedrich's class, or this actual complex in the spaces, which do not have integrated edges. Independently, the mathematical physics literature, similar potentials of Schrodinger operators have been considered. That also fits the bill. We have seen that for the hour. So those are in that context as well. There's a very important paper by Houdini and Seeley who looked at these types of operators that I gave you just as an example in 87, but also only the Friedrich extension, where you just recover the usual behavior. So the expectation that has been around was actually fueled also by those theorems. It just nothing much is going on in the equations of certain logarithmic terms. There is a very nice line of work in the book on Session, and money is the book is number 7, that for the first time tried to get a hold on this for a fully general class of this operator, but you have to assume a lot of things to actually make the lattice work. Okay. Also, in the situations that he considered, you actually recover the usual behavior of the resolving spaces. So, another piece of evidence in quotation marks that things should be fine, even for one of the singularities, the same structural. So outside the self-adjoint realm, they're not yet independently from each other, consider the minimal extension. This is like our theorem now for questioning things, I generalize, of course, and those unusual behaviors, as I told you, they're just discovered fairly recently by Seeley in collaboration with several physicists. and found that designing if I looked at only E models, regular singular only E models, and actually computed a brute force, whoops, there's a theta function that has unusual poles. That was rather unexpected. And also in the line of work, generalizing this, Klaus Kirsten for origins in the park, looked at this type of operator associated with the Brillian series examples, and actually were able to consider general centripetal extensions of this operator by means of separation of variables and special function techniques earlier on. And actually were able to establish these strange behaviors that we just have seen in the current principle, and they actually showed it didn't occur. So you do have unusual poles in the Laplace. You do have theta functions that do not extend. Even for that kind of very nice operator that is associated with a straight cone method, so there's no wiggling and warping. Okay? This already occurs there. Well, here's some wedge operators. So again, in the context of what I was talking about, it's the second case of doing the CG91 that considered second order operator physics extension on the space of things for that. And the systematic approach towards elliptic theory for this kind of operator in the complete case, piloting from a singular 91. In the incomplete case, I've actually been talking about by Schulz in 91, and there is a higher stream of inversion and application that has been found. But strangely, people have avoided the spectral questions until very recently. Not quite sure of my time.
You've got about 4 or 5 minutes.
So this is a huge overstatement of what I'm going to do. I'm not about going to sketch the proof. But I give you some bits and pieces of ideas. Well, and the idea is, of course, you may see these very original idea work in the same situation. So let's see these very original idea. When you take a result, you approximate it or actually identify it as an object in some superfine calculus that you construct from scratch and that you understand fully. So all the components, the symbolic components of the calculus, you fully understand, they are topics you understand, and once you identify the objects in the calculus, you understand the fields and topics of it. What we have been using here, since we are in the incomplete case, we have been using the adapted version of the two differential calculus of Schulz, and the challenge here is always identify. So what kind of structures you get on the boundary? So when you're trying to construct a parametric, you invert, you compose, you're trying to make a Neumann series argument work, you have all kinds of terms, compositions that you need to understand, and that causes all kinds of trouble. Okay? So there are remainder terms that you get, so some of them you can understand in symbolic terms, and remainder terms means you have some operators that are smoothing the interior, but then still not compact or regularizing at the boundary, and those terms you have to explain and control somehow. And an idea that is used in Schulz calculus is that of these operator like symbols, and that came in rather handy for us here as well. So what is that idea? It's a very technical thing, but it works. It really works. So it's an abstract thing. It's an Hilbert space system that you're equipped with abstractly. It's only for the interpretation of a multiplicative group. So you have a group parameterized by the positive reals, rho. And what it is in practice here, E and tilde, is a certain function spaces on the fiber, rather on the cone of the fiber. So a Sobolev space is a very bad regularity, very bad behavior in the boundary, into other Sobolev spaces that are very smooth and have a very good behavior. And the representation is scaling. So you scale by a positive scalar like this is the natural action that you have on the cone. And such a twisted operator like the symbol is just an ordinary symbol, you would say. So there's an ordinary symbol estimate, so forget about this anisotropic behavior here in Cooper, it's a parameter. This is really just a parameter in Cooper. It's different orders, so different than the same level. Well, the standard estimates, except that you actually have to sandwich by scaling. Happens that this very structure works out rather nicely. So there is, by the way, associated to that also the notion of homogeneity in classical circles. Here's the notion of classical circles. such a thing has an extension into homogeneous components for large beta lambda, and homogeneity is not quite homogeneity as you would think, but rather this kind of homogeneity. So we have to scale here, we have a pull out of the new minus J. Well, you can pull it out up to conjugation by the scaling of the normal. And what is the case, what happens here is, and that's part of Joseph Kleinberg's actually showed that, when in the process of going through the graphics construction, the remainders that you have to control, well, you can control them in these terms, like this. So you take function spaces, as I said, on this cone of the base, and that is essentially distributions with bad behavior on the boundary into very smooth functions with good behavior at the boundary. And the operators that you get is a two-step quantization, so this takes care of the x variable, and now we're taking care of the y variables with the standard quantization. Those things happen to end up being operators that are smoothing away from the boundary received in the kernel, but that kind of language allows you to say what happens on the boundary with those kernels. So they're quantized objects in these terms. And the regularizing ones, the ones that we throw away, they correspond to orders here that are negative infinity. And then, just to make the long story short, when you have these terms, and again, going from distribution to bad regularity into smooth function, one regularity also to the boundary, that happens then, that is true, you can get into trace class operators in there. Yeah? So you apply the trace to that. And when you apply the trace to this identity, because you apply the trace, you apply the trace, but the trace property, the set which you know is a problem. So this means when you apply the trace in normal direction, you just end up recovering ordinary homogeneous scalar circles. And then, essentially, by Fubini's theorem, and you want to figure out what the trace with respect to all variables of this thing, whether you take the trace, everything, first take the trace in the x z variables, and the trace in the y variable. So this amounts to this expression. It's about this quantity. And that thing here is now an ordinary symbol. So therefore, the usual procedure works. This asymptotic thing is homogeneity that you get out of this gives a standard extension. And then there's more work to that, and take care of what you know. So this is how we do that. And the point is, this description with those genes that are just taken, they only work on the limit domain. They only work on the limit domain. And when the task is done, how to describe it, it's not the limit domain. And there are a lot more that's happening as well. Thank you.
From the domain of the actual operator to the domain.
Domain of what?
How you get from the domain of the actual operator, edge operator, to the domain of this associated A edge?
Yes, I will have to show you this because it's a little long and technical. So you have to see it. I mean, it's not an answer that you can give. Okay, but it's better.